A Mystery in the Kitchen by Olive Thorne Miller. The boy who has a sister and the girl who has a brother are the ones who will best like this story of the spirited twins, Jesse and Jack. Jesse wanted to take music lessons and Jack tried mining in Colorado. Something very mysterious was going on in the Jarvis kitchen. The table was covered with all sorts of good things, eggs and butter and raisins and citron and spices, and Jessie, with her sleeves rolled up and a white apron on, was bustling about, measuring and weighing and chopping and beating and mixing those various ingredients in a most bewildering way. Moreover, though she was evidently working for dear life, her face was full of smiles. In fact, she seemed to have trouble to keep from laughing. Outright, while Betty, the cook, who was washing potatoes at the sink, fairly giggled with glee every few minutes, as if the sight of Miss Jessie working in the kitchen was the drollest thing in the world. It was one of the pleasantest sights that big, sunny kitchen had seen for many a day, and the only thing that appeared mysterious about it was that the two workers acted strangely like conspirators. If they laughed, as they did on the slightest provocation, it was very soft and at once smothered. Jessie went often to the door leading into the hall, and listened, and if there came a knock on the floor, she snatched off her apron, hastily wiped her hands, rolled down her sleeves, asked Betty if there was any flour on her, and then hurried away into another part of the house, trying to look cool and quiet, as if she had not been doing anything. On returning from one of these excursions, as she rolled up her sleeves again, she said, "Betty, we must open the other window if it is cold." Mama thought she smelled roast turkey. Betty burst into a laugh which she smothered in her apron. Jessie covered her mouth and laughed, too, but the window was opened to make a draft and carry out the delicious odors, which, it must be confessed, did fill that kitchen so full that no wonder they crept through the cracks, and the keyholes, and hung about Jessie's dress as she went through the hall, in a way to make one's mouth water. "What did ye tell her?" asked Betty, as soon as she could speak. "Oh, I told her I thought Popeye smelled a good deal like turkey," said Jessie, and again both laughed. "Wasn't it lucky we had Popeye today? I don't know what I should have said if we hadn't." Well, it was not long after that when Jessie lined a baking dish with nice-looking crust, filled it with tempting-looking chicken legs and wings and breasts and backs and a bowlful of broth, laid a white blanket of crust over all, tucked it in snugly around the edge, cut some holes in the top, and shoved it into the oven just after Betty drew out a dripping pan in which reposed, in all the glory of rich brown skin, a beautiful turkey. Mrs. Jarvis couldn't have had any nose at all if she didn't smell that. It filled the kitchen full of nice smells, and Betty hurried it into the pantry, where the window was open to cool. Then Jessie returned to the spices and fruits she had been working over so long, and a few minutes later she poured a rich, dark mass into a tin pudding dish, tied the cover on tight, and slipped it into a large kettle of boiling water on the stove. "There," she said, "I hope that'll be good." "I know it will," said Betty confidently. "That's Wire Ma's best receipt." "Yes, but I never made it before," said Jessie doubtfully. "Oh, I know it'll be all right, and I'll watch it close," said Betty, "and now you go and sit with Wire Ma. I want that table to get dinner, but I'm going to wash all these things," said Jessie. "You go long. I'd ruther do that myself. 'Twon't take me no time," said Betty. Jessie hesitated. "But you have enough to do, Betty." "I tell you I want to do it," the girl insisted. "Oh, I know," said Jessie, "you like to help about it." "Well, you may, and I'm much obliged to you, besides." And after a last look at the fine turkey cooling his heels, if he had any, in the pantry, Jessie went into the other part of the house. When dinner time arrived and Papa came from town, there duly appeared on the table the Popeye before mentioned, and various other things pleasant to eat, but nothing was seen of the turkey so carefully roasted, nor of the chicken pie, nor of the pudding that caused the young cook so much anxiety. Nothing was said about them, either, and it was not Thanksgiving nor Christmas, though it was only a few days before the former. It was certainly odd, and stranger things happened that night. In the first place, Jessie sat up in her room and wrote a letter, and then, after her mother was in bed and everything still, she stole down the back stairs with a candle, quietly, as though she was doing some mischief. Betty, who came down to help her, brought a box in from the woodshed, and the two plotters, very silently, with many listenings at the door to see if anyone was stirring, packed that box full of good things. In it the turkey, wrapped in a snowy napkin, found a bed, the chicken pie and the plum pudding, beautiful looking as Betty said it would be, bore him. company, and numerous small things, jam jars, fruits, etc., etc., filled the box to its very top. Then the cover, provided with screws so that no hammering need be done, was fastened on. "Now you go to bed, Miss Jessie," whispered Betty. "All wait, no, you must be tired," said Jessie. "I'd just as lief, but I'd ruther," said Betty shortly, "and I'm going to, it won't be long now." So Jessie crept quietly upstairs, and before long there was a low rap on the kitchen door. Betty opened it, and there stood a man. "Ready?" said he. "Yes," answered Betty, "but don't speak loud, Miss Jarvis has sharp ears, and we don't want her disturbed. Here's the card to mark it by," and she produced a card from the table. The man put it in his pocket, shouldered the box, and Betty shut the door. Not one of those good things ever went into the Jarvis dining room. The next morning things went on just as usual in the house. The kitchen door was left open and Mrs. Jarvis was welcome to smell any of the appetizing odors that wafted out into her room. Jessie resumed her study, and especially her practice, for she hoped someday to be a great musician. She waited on her mother and took charge of the housekeeping, so much as was necessary with the well-tried servant at the head of the kitchen. And though she had but 16 years over her bright brown head, she proved herself to be what in that little New England town was called capable. But that box of goodies. Let us see where it went. It was Thanksgiving morning in a rough-looking little mining settlement in Colorado. In a shanty rougher and more comfortless than the rest were two persons. One, a man of 30, was deeply engaged in cleaning and oiling a gun which lay in pieces about him on the rough bench where he sat. The other, a youth of 16, was trying to make a fire burn in the primitive-looking affair that did duty as a stove. Both wore coarse miner's suits, and picks and other things about the room told that their business was to dig for the yellow dust we are all so greedy to have. Evidently luck had not been good, for the whole place appeared run down, and the two looked absolutely hungry. It was Thanksgiving morning, as I said, but no thankfulness shone in the two pale, thin faces. Both were sad, and the younger one almost hopeless. "Jack," said the elder, pausing in his operations, "mind you give that old hen a good boil, or we won't be able to eat it."
"It'll be better'n nothing, anyway, I suppose," said Jack gloomily. "Not much. Especially if you don't get the taste of sagebrush out of it. Lucky I happened to get that shot at her, anyway," he went on. "I've seen worse dinners, even Thanksgiving dinners, than a sage hen." "I haven't," said Jack shortly, for the mention of Thanksgiving had brought up before him with startling vividness the picture of a bright dining room in a certain town far away, a table loaded with good things, and surrounded by smiling faces, and the contrast was almost more than he could bear.
"Well, don't be down on your luck, boy, so long as you can get a good fat hen to eat, if she does happen to be too fond of seasoning before she's dead," replied the other cheerfully. "We haven't struck it yet, but it's always darkest just before dawn, you know. We may be millionaires before this time tomorrow, we may," answered Jack, but he didn't look as if he had much hope of it. A few hours later the occupants of the cabin sat down to their Thanksgiving dinner. It consisted of the hen aforesaid, cut in pieces and boiled, looking very queer, too, served in the kettle in which the operation had been performed. The table was at one end of the bench, the table service two jackknives and two iron spoons, absolutely nothing else. The elder sat on the bench, the younger drew up a keg that had held powder, and the dinner was about to begin. But that hen was destined never to be eaten, for just at that moment the door was pushed open in the rude way of the country, a box set down on the floor, and a rough voice announced, "A box for Mr. Jack Jones." Jack started up. "For me, there must be a mistake. Nobody knows." He stopped, for he had not mentioned that his name was assumed.
"Likely not," said the man, with a knowing look, "but folks has a mighty queer way of findin' out," and he shut the door and left.